understand, like,
yeah, people want to day trade and, you know, put in $10,000, risk $10,000 to make $10,000. And, you know, there's we're obviously in a downtrend due to all these types of risks and uncertainty, inflation, interest rates, and stuff like that. But based on experience, when we're in a downtrend like this and the bottom is formed, right now we're getting very, very close to the bottom, the 4,000 S&P gap. And whether it fills or not, it's going to fill. It's a gap that's been open for almost a year. And when it fills, it's going to fill and probably flush. Right now, the VIX futures is trading exactly like the image that I posted here. So it's expected to form a rounding base and then spike higher to do a double top. Okay, double tops are probably one of the best times to look to do a counter trend position. And that's the VIX. And this assumption of the VIX is not only because of the shape and form factor of the daily candlestick of the VIX, but it's also motivated by the gap in the S&P futures at 4,000. Okay, so that's what's giving us a little bit more reason to hold out for that flush. If we take a look at the S&P futures, we're not that far away from that. You can see if you kind of do this upside down, it actually looks like a cup and handle pattern. So there's this cup, the handle, and then if it breaks out, then we're down here. Okay, this week, maybe by, man, it's so hard to say if it's tomorrow or by Wednesday. Nobody knows. This is the tough part. Okay, so I really wanted to buy some puts, especially on the SPY, but the SPY is so slow. You can still make 100% on it, but it's so slow, and you can see what happened today. For example, a really good example is Tesla. So Tesla is the one that I'm actually looking. Tesla or Shopify, these two stocks, and Nvidia, or just in general, all the tech stocks have an amazing gap filling characteristic. Whenever there's a gap, it always tends to fill it. So if you take a look at Tesla today, you can see the levels on my chart here from last night's video. They were almost precisely to the 1618 to the 1272. Whether you took the position or not, that's totally up to you, right? But this is it. Like, that's how good these Fibonacci things are. And did I profit off this? No, because my plan is a little bit different. My plan is to wait for that flush. And if it doesn't come, then it doesn't come. We go straight to TGIF, right? Then we do trade Friday and sell on Monday and Tuesday once the market starts picking up. But if we get lucky on this flush, right, then we're going to get a pretty good risk and reward where we risk $1,000 and we'll probably make about $5,000 to $7,000, okay, depending on which day of the week we're in. So let's talk about so this is the image, the Fibonacci extension that I drew last night. Okay, so you can take a look at the video. This is, so you can see how accurate it is. However, you don't know if it's going to go to the 1272 or gap straight to the 1.618. Or is it going to go, like, you know, how is it going to get there? Is it going to go down in the straight line, or is it going to bounce? So you can see there's a wick there today, right here. Okay, there's that wick. Now, if I remove everything and we go to the 30-minute time frame. Actually, not the 30-minute, probably like the 5-minute time frame. You can see that as it is dumped right down here, it reversed and went back to the green. And they actually left that small little gap there open at 800. That would have been a very, so if you shorted at the open and it moved all the way down to 761, that was like a 5% drop. Everyone's like, I do both shares. I do shares that's traded automatically, you know, using the algorithms. And they were all up, like making huge amounts of money. Well, not huge, but I think that's average for Tesla, but making enough. And it was great until they reversed and gave back all those gains. Okay, and in options, if we got here, you would have figured out how to manage at least on this candle. And then you would have, I don't know what you would have done here. And then at that, after that, you can see that just tapered off. These are very, very brutal, especially when you're a bull. So what can I say from this? Well, like I always been talking about, Tesla, Roku, Shopify, these techs, their average move is around 4%. I think Tesla's around 4.2 and Roku is around 4.75. Shopify is around 6. That's the average move for these stocks. And it went all the way down to 5% and then went positive at one point right around here. And I guess that would have been a good time to short again, right? But this is not a clockwork type of pattern. Like this is, there's no way that people can trade this with a high degree of accuracy, right? So I would, because of this, the nature of the market and how it does these things, what we want to do is just kind of understand the characteristics of the company's price action. So the first characteristic of Tesla is that we know that it makes around a 4.5% move plus or minus on any given day, right? If it moves and it's an average positive move that's, you know, a good day, then you're expected to see 4% extra in your account. And if it's a bad day, then you're expected to see a negative 4 to 5% move if you're short in your account or loss in your account, right? Whatever position you take. So that's, and in the past 2 to 3 weeks, we've been seeing, you see the average move, right? It's either 4, or if it really takes a big move, it's a 2 standard deviation move, then you get maybe an 8% move, right? And 2 weeks ago, we got that 8% move when Tesla was gapping down 8%. And then that was the day that Apple gapped down 5, remember? Apple's average move is around 1.25. So let's take a look at Apple quickly here. So even Apple, as it gapped down, right, it already achieved its average move and then immediately bounced significantly right at the open. Okay, so in conclusion, when you see these gaps, then especially gap down in the pre-market, the first thing you're thinking is about the gap fill, right? And Tesla is one of these stocks that has a very aggressive and violent gap fill behavior. Okay, so that's the first thing you want to understand, that there's this thing that happens, and we see it over and over again. Whenever there is a gap down, we get a violent move higher. All right, next thing we want to do is take a look at Tesla using Bollinger Bands and compare that to last week's trade. And yeah, I know everyone wants to day trade, but I'm just trying to look for an opportunity to make some excellent trades where we get this flush, and the flush is coming for sure, and hopefully we can catch that. So let's see the Bollinger Band here, and then I'm gonna add and RSI just for reference. Which RSI would I use? Yeah, it's okay. Just maybe duplicate that. This one looks low. Yeah, I guess that's fine. Yeah, so I guess I don't need that. And they're kind of identical. Okay. So here's a Bollinger Band, and actually I want to probably put on another Bollinger Band and then apply a standard deviation to it. So I got duplicates of a Bollinger Band here. And what I want to do is have the input, that's 2, so 4 standard deviation. Okay. All right, so that's called the double Bollinger Band. And 2 standard deviation might be a little bit too big, so I would say 1.8. Okay, so that's just smoothens it a little bit. All right, so that's what we're looking at right now in terms of the Bollinger Band. So 2 weeks ago when we saw Tesla gapping down 8%, that was a 4 standard deviation, like I mentioned before. We should come to an agreement that Tesla, under volatile conditions where price is whipsawing up and down, the average whipsaw is around 4 to 5%, plus or minus. Now, if one of those whipsaws is 4 standard deviations plus or minus, that means that we're getting that that flush, right? Because the 4 standard deviation doesn't happen very often. And maybe it doesn't happen because 4 standard deviation happened here. And is it going to happen again here? Okay. So it could. It could flush all the way down to 668. And that would be an opportunity for us to get in long Tesla. So the question is, when do we get in? Okay, so if we get the flush tomorrow, let's take a look at the futures. The futures, the VIX is starting to curl here. Last night I talked about the continuation pattern of the VIX. And then you can see here on the NASDAQ, if I make this bigger, looks like the sell def and buy def and dip tier one triggered again. And let's maximize this. You can see that we are getting a little bit extended. We got some extensions here, right? So a little bit of a, we should fear the mean reversion. Mean reversions suck, especially when your whole account is net short, right? You're just giving back all those profits. But a hedge is a hedge, right? That's what we have to deal with. So that's a 1.77% difference between the price here and the 6-day moving average. And I think if the market continues to sell off, right, at 4 a.m. Eastern time, and it's dropping another 1.5-1.7%, then this is an opportunity to buy the dip at the open, depending on the pre-market price or percentage move. So if Tesla makes a 4% move again already in the pre-market on Tuesday, then the move is done to the downside and we're looking for a gap fill. It took the whole entire day for Tesla to move down to 4% after moving 5% within the first 30 minutes of the day, or actually the first 5 minutes of the day. Right? If you take a look today on the 5-minute time frame, Tesla moved all the way down to 761, which is a little lower. It actually hit the 1.618 extension in the video that I made last night. So I did not trade this. I am looking to capture greater than four standard deviation move on the gap, on the flush, on the next flush down. So that we you can see it sells off and then it bounces, and that would have been brutal if we started to chase the sell-off, right? So the market is very, very tricky with in terms of options. In terms of shares, common shares, I mean, anybody should be able to make money on common shares. The real secret is whether you can automate it and make money doing nothing. That's the secret, right? Because that's the whole point of scaling. You want to reach, you want to scale systems so that you don't have to do so much work, right? Imagine if you're managing, like if you think about, ideally, if you manage hundreds of millions of dollars, do you think you're actually sitting there pressing numbers and calculating Amazon and looking for bull flags and bear flags? No, of course not. You're at another level, right? You have to have a machine do it for you. That's the whole point, right? You know, we evolve as humans. We buy cars to make our lives easier. We take planes to fly things. Like, machines are pretty much a part of our life, right? And when you're dealing with hundreds of millions of dollars, you're not sitting there drawing lines with bear flags and bull flags. You're having systems do it for you. But for options, it's not that easy, right? Nobody can really automate options. The only way you can automate options is if your account is big enough to buy 100 shares. If you buy 100 shares, that's basically you have one contract. So essentially, when we trade Roku or we trade Apple, I'm buying like 1,000 shares. That's 10 contracts, okay? And there's no decay. That's the only way I know how to automate options. Anything else, I don't think it's really that easy to automate options, especially when you have experience just trading common shares. There are like tons of problems that can come about. So you don't want to be, you know, I mean, you have to have a really good, I don't even think an system even exists where you can automate options. But anyways, back to the trading plan. My trading plan is still waiting for this flush in the S&P. And whether we get this week or not, that's the big question, right? This is the let's say we risk about $1,000 and we get a nice flush right here. That would be a huge, huge opportunity to make a lot of money on an asymmetric trade. So what are we trying to look for? Okay, what we want to look for is a massive red candle any one of these days that fills this gap, and it has to happen while everyone's sleeping. Okay, and then second of all, the next condition is that those tech names that have been beaten up to death, they will have to be moving lower, much lower than the average move. So for example, Tesla, we want to see it down another 4 to 5, 6, 7%. And if it does, then we're looking to buy the dip because it's going to gap. So Tesla's got this BLT, right? And it could move down. So last week moved down, what, 5, 6%? So on this BLT here, if we're lucky and it gaps down 6%, then the candle starts forming at 720. And if it does that, then you have an opportunity to trade the gap up to 766, but at the same time, it could do the same thing that it did today and then roll over afternoon and then move down to 650, 680 to maybe 600. There's even a good chance that Tesla goes all the way down to 569. Okay, Elon Musk's favorite number, 69. That's when I think the Apollo moon landing was. Okay, so that's the flush. And then if it flushes even more, right, then the risk and reward is going to be much greater. Some caveats to keep in mind is that if the move if the if the pre-market moves just flat tomorrow, so for example, futures trade flat all night long, then what's going to happen is a stock like Tesla, a stock like Apple, they're going to open up flat and they're going to try to retest the 6-day moving average of 793. Okay, because each green dot here, I mean, if we take an average of this, that's what, 834, 8, so let's say $20. So $10 drop, for example, from 815 to 805. The next 6-day moving average that should be forming the green dot would be around here where that wick is, 800. That would be the time to look for a short if you want a short. Okay, and then it's going to go and decide to trade above the 6-day moving average or trade below it and then form a BLT to the downside and flush really hard all day long. And if it does a double bottom here at 700, 10 seconds into the close would be a great time to buy some calls on Tesla on Tuesday at the end of the day. Okay, because I don't know, nobody knows what the next candlestick is going to look like here, right? You have to agree. You're going to make an assumption, obviously. You're going to say, oh, I think it's going to go down because it's going down, everything's going down, whatever. Use any simple logic you want. But if you're looking for an area to buy something that's cheap and make a shitload of money, then you want to look to these extreme levels. So you can see the Bollinger Band here, the four standard deviations at 666. Wow, that's pretty interesting. So 666, if that makes a lower, if Tesla sells off really long and hard, and that's a really long and hard candle, like that's a 13% drop in Tesla. And that would be, and if we get a nice long and hard candle like that, okay, I might give it a shot on some weekly calls, right? If they leave, especially if they leave a gap open. But I would prefer if the market was flushing while we're sleeping and it's down like 2-3% and everything else is like dumping 4-7%. That would be ideal. The less ideal is just to wait for this thing to move down to 700 for a double bottom, or if we use some sort of, you know, some Fibonacci garbage retracements, then let's say it's already pushed through the 618, so double bottom would be a higher low would be anywhere around this level. So essentially we're cashing a falling knife, okay? And then it can easily break down through the 700 and then fill these gaps at 569 all the way down to 520 all the way down to 400. Who knows? Nobody will know, right? Roku used to be trading at 400, now it's at 100. And you have to think about, like, this is a great opportunity to make a lot of money in the next 5 years. Like, I can't even imagine how much when we make a new 52-week high in the markets, you know, this is going to be nuts. But a lot of people are losing a lot of money, and it is just, it's absolutely disgusting. So instead of just day trading, I would just wait. We're not too far away from that flush, right? This is around 4,020, and it could happen anytime. So that's the 3.72. That usually happens in around 2 days. There's no, there was a 7-8 minute TTM squeeze earlier in the day, and then there's one that just kind of didn't do anything. But my plan here is once this gap fills and how it fills, that's going to be the time where I'm going to be looking to go long, right? I don't want to, the trading the put action here is pretty damn difficult. Especially when you have to alert everybody to get in and get out. So I think the easiest way is if it flushes all the way down to 4,021, which I'm expecting it to be on Wednesday or Thursday, which makes the options cheaper on Thursday and Friday, then there's going to be a great opportunity to buy some long calls for a nice sharp bounce, because that's this is a pretty strong, this is a pretty significant support level, as you can see. And yeah, you know, during this time when this gap was open, I did try to attempt a couple of these gap fills, the trades on the puts, and it didn't work. I lost money on it, just like I'm losing money on these ones, because you can see how difficult. Well, I made quite a bit on this one right here, but all these other ones, you can see how choppy the market is. It's very difficult to trade it unless you have, you know, exceptional entry, or you have, or you just trade really, really small. But this gap has been open for a year, almost a year now. It's open since April 1st, and we were trading long most of the time, from here all the way up to here. And then finally, we are going through this massive correction, and it should end once this gap fills. Okay. And when you take a look at the price action today, and you see how prices are moving, and sometimes they don't even move at all. Like, I saw Shopify move, and it didn't move for like a good 3 or 5 minutes, right? It just stayed flat. This is not your typical market. And this is obviously going through some major corrections with a lot of uncertainty and volatility. So prices are going to move back and forth, up and down, all through the day. And it's going to be a little bit nerve-wracking. So what I would suggest is, you know, it's already kind of rolling over here. I would just wait to see, like, the plan for what I expect to do is watch how the NASDAQ trades all night. Okay, I'll be watching that. And what I really want to see as well is this VIX candle sharply move higher and form a nice big green, long and green candle. When you see a long and green candle on the VIX futures, that is going to be like the biggest gift ever. Okay, because it's already gone top, it's already made a 52 week high here, and it's going to make another attempt, but obviously it's going to come into some resistance, right? The longer the green candle, not these two, we don't want these small little candles. We want a long candle like this one right here, or like this one right here. Nice long 10-15% day on the VIX when the markets are not even open. That's going to be a gift to get ready to buy some calls, buy the F and dip, and to trade that gap fill. In the meantime, it looks like it's just slow and steady, and we don't know if it's going to rip up tomorrow. We don't know if it's going to be on Wednesday or Thursday. We don't know when it's going to make a new 52 week high in the VIX, and that's the problem. Nobody knows when this gap is going to get filled. I thought I could figure out when this was going to get filled back here. I thought it was going to be on this leg, but that didn't happen. And guess what? 1 year later, it's right here. So we're getting, this is a complicated bottom that's being placed. We actually have inverted head and shoulders. Okay, so then you can actually draw the infamous line here. It doesn't have to be that correct. It just has to be a line that kind of does something like this. Connects at least two points in space. That connects actually three. And it could move lower, which I think it's definitely going to move lower, but we don't know when it's going to fill this gap. It could easily move up higher, break out, and then roll over. So that just kicks the can down the road even longer. But timing this gap fill is not as easy as I think. And this is a beautiful example of showing how some of the gaps, when they're opened, they're very, very hard to time, especially this one. But like I mentioned before, when the gap fills, I think that's when the whole entire geopolitical risks happening over in overseas is probably going to be mute. Okay, so, you know, it's already done. Like, the invasion is pretty much done. There's nothing really Ukraine can do. I'm not an expert on any of that stuff. I just know that if you just put a whole bunch of tanks around the country, I mean, you're pretty much in control, right? So if you're in control, if Ukraine was in control, I think they should put a whole bunch of tanks in Russia, but they're not in control. They're defending. So it's obviously there's a big difference between the military power. But it's already done. Like, that's done, and then it looks like the gap in the S&P is coinciding when the invasion is completely official. Like, it's done. Okay, something is going to happen this week, and believe it or not, I think this gap, whoever made that gap here in April, actually knew that this war was going to be taking place. That's just my feeling. My conspiracy. It's the same thing with the 9/11 Trade Center. There was like a huge A6, A7 scanning, and then the market sold off, and then the two planes crashed on two consecutive A6s. So that also raised some eyebrows for me, at least, to think that, you know, it was somebody priced in that the plane was going to crash into the buildings. But that's obviously just a theory, right? But it's kind of uncanny to see an A6. And it's also very unusual to see a gap here fill at the same time when the invasion is officially complete. We'll see if that's true. And we also have FOMC coming up on Wednesday. So that's Jay Powell. So Jay Powell has expressed his opinion about the economic conditions. It's super strong. Everyone has great jobs, making like $100 an hour. However, you know, because of the inflation, there's what some of the tools that he has under his belt, like raising interest rates of 25 basis points this week, to make it official. It will be announced, and whatever he says after is going to be how the market's going to, is the real reaction that the market's going to show. So we might get so for the futures going into FOMC, we might get a little bit of a pop and then a drop. I really don't know, so I prefer not to trade. Like, there's just too much guessing, right? I prefer just to have that flush. That removes a lot of the guessing, because the reasoning is we know what the expected moves for Apple, Amazon, and Shopify are. And if Amazon, so Shopify is down another 6% tomorrow morning, that's the average move. So I don't have to guess which way it's going to go. I've never seen. I've never seen an extremely oversold position not attempt a gap fill within the first 30 minutes, especially on these techs. Now, the way to trade Shopify, that's another thing, right? The could be either zero DTEs or contracts for next week, but that will all depend on which ones are gapping down the most in the morning. Is it Apple? Is it Tesla? Or is it Facebook? We had mRNA go up 20% today and gave back a good chunk of that, 12%, which I did not trade. That was something that I really wanted to trade, but I was like, I should stick to my plan, right? Because let's take a look at the chart here. See, when it moved up here, you can see that the UTL wasn't following the yellow crosses. So that created a mean reversion. This is like an ideal setup for a mean reversion when you see something like that. And then you kind of have to figure out, it was moving, I looked at the chart, it was moving toward the 50-day moving average. That was for mRNA. That's that white line right there. And you can see the 50-day moving average. 50-day moving average. Yeah, the 50-day moving average. Price moved right toward that, and that was resistance as the price moved away from the UTL. So it started to finally reverse on the right after the second 30-minute candle. So that's two cycles on a 30-minute time frame. That would have been the time to short, and then for a mean reversion down to 142, which I did not do, okay? Because I'm still looking for a flush. And I thought that mRNA was going to drop down to 100, right? So this is a very tricky market, and I would just kind of be a little bit careful with even getting into puts tomorrow, because we are, well, it looks like the futures are bouncing, but look at the bounce. Like, even these small little bounces here, that where the Nasdaq is up 0.48, that could easily move Tesla like 2 to 3%, right? This is a pretty damn slow market correction. But again, there could be easily a turnaround Tuesday. Like, you can even see that the Tesla algorithm in the pre-market is still moving higher. I mean, there's no way you can figure this out, right? So what I plan to do is just wait for that flush. And if we get the flush, then I'll be coming on voice talking about it, preparing for it. But if we don't get the flush, then I'll be looking to open up a trade on Thursday or Friday for TGIF. So I won't do any like weeklies. I'll do contracts that expire the following week, because they didn't work out the last week. So in the meantime, the path of least resistance is still down, but as it moves down, it bounces, right? And this cup and handle pattern here, it's going to eventually break out, because there's a magic mic wick right here, and that's going to cause the market to sell off, eventually filling this 4,000 gap. Let me just show you how bad it is out there. So this guy, I kind of follow, but I'm just kind of wondering like what this guy does. And there's nothing wrong with his trading style, but this guy started off with $1 million, $1.2 million in April. And he's now at $492,000. So you might be saying, why, Roger, are you looking at someone else's account or the way of trading? And the reason why I'm bringing this is up because the person is trading common shares. And in common shares, you should never, ever let your account drop more than 50%, like this person has done. And the weird thing is, I think they're always buying calls, like you can see. He actually deleted a tweet. Oh, yeah. I think. See, like, you can read how bad the sentiment is. This is great business for me, because all I have to do is, you know, contact them and say, hey, you want to stop losing money and make money, right? Protect your account. So this person's down 70K in 3 months, unrealized. This is tough. Why would anyone, and you have to think about it, when a stock like Roku or any stock that, let's say Shop, when a stock like this, is down 70%, right? Just think about how long it's going to take for them to make that money back. Average return on Apple, which is one of the best stocks to own, is around 15 to 20% per year. So just to get this back up to 52-week highs, it's going to take at least 3 years. Okay, so they're they're holding through a massive drawdown without even knowing how low this thing can go. I think it could even go lower, down to 300, right? But they're holding massive losses in their accounts. And the weird thing is, the way that they post their P&L like this, with a lot of transparency, which is respectable, but at the same time, they don't know what they're doing. It's very, very scary out there. Okay, people like this, who maybe inherited money, they get a nice good run in the bull market, and they show these fantastic gains on a day-to-day basis. Thank God they're transparent, because this is data for me to understand what kind of people are out there, and these are very, very dangerous people on Twitter. Okay, not like they're bad people. They're doing their best to try to survive. But the way that they display their information and they approach the market is super, super dangerous. You're gonna go bankrupt and go broke like this. You're gonna go into deep shit. Okay, this makes no sense how they buy all these garbage stocks. 6,000 here, 200 here, no idea. Okay, and I wouldn't be surprised if this account goes down to about 300,000 to 200,000 by the end of December. This is really brutal. So yeah, I follow this guy because this guy is like pretty transparent. I don't follow a lot of people, but he actually deleted a tweet. Okay, I think he will be back to seven figures by the end of the year. Yeah, but he obviously understands that it's going to take longer than that. So if you have, like, not just to talk about 750R, 750R keeps that balance flat or even higher, okay? So you're not wasting another 3 or 4 years of your life getting your money back, okay? This is not a period where you are trying to think that you're better than the market. You're not. Not even I'm better than the market. The system will do its thing to protect your net worth. But the worst thing that you can do is write a sentence like this and say, that would be nice, but I'd imagine it'd take longer than that, and you're drawing down by $600,000. That's not acceptable. People would jump out of buildings and commit suicide on things like this. This is how dangerous the market is. Even when you're trading common shares, you can't really lose money on common shares. Like, you can't. It's not the same thing as options. When you trade common shares, you're not going to go to zero, right? But 50% is a pretty big number. And think about it. If it drops, if that's Shopify, let's see what Roku is. And the average return on a stock, like, these are high growth stocks, so their average moves per year could be like 30%. It could be 2 years, it could be three, nobody knows, right? And they also run the risk of going bankrupt. But for sure, I think there's, because I'm a bull, there's lots of gaps above here that will eventually fill. But the main assumption here is it's not going to fill until the S&P gap fills the 4,000 first. And watching, if you have 750R and we see the markets dumping tomorrow morning, then we got to close all the positions, right? So that's just a no-brainer. Like, I see people closing positions off for no reason. They don't even tell me. They just do whatever they want because they think they know what they're doing. Nobody knows what they're doing, okay? I think I have like 1% knowledge, more knowledge than everybody else. But no one knows exactly what this market is going to do. All we know is that there's a gap. We don't know when it's going to get filled. We know it's been trying to fill for a year. And if it flushes, we know average moves like in these stocks could do 4%, 5% a day. And if you're getting 4 to 5% in a day at the open, then close it off in the pre-market, right? Why don't you think like this, right? Nobody gives you 4% right at the beginning of the day. Just manage, right? But as long as you understand why you're managing, not just because you feel like you need to manage, you have to know why you're managing, okay? And then that's why people pay me the big bucks. You have to know what you're doing so that you can take on seven-figure risk and absorb it, okay? You can't just do this crazy stuff that parrot guy does. It's really, really dangerous. I wouldn't be surprised to see him in the hospital because of all the the stress that he's hiding, right? I've been there before when I was 27, and I was able to survive it because I was young and strong. But as you get older, you can't afford to lose $600,000 in 1 year, okay? That's $600,000 in 1 year with an average account that people have with me. That would take, 7 years. So he erased 7 years of his life, right? That's not acceptable. Hey, because you don't know if you're going to live in the next 7 years. And probably, the health becomes a big issue. Okay, so basically, the market is obviously in a downtrend. We're still waiting for the gap to fill. The day trading on puts is extremely dangerous, as I outlined here in Tesla. I don't even think, even if I alert it, I think people will still be delayed in getting into the position and probably not get in with the right entry. So to avoid those situations, like look at Tesla. Tesla just keeps on bouncing for no reason, like even after hours, right? It's brutal. Like how would you prevent that from happening when you have a short position? You can't. So, but what I'm saying here is that we're looking for the flush, and then if we get a gap of 4% to 5% this week on Tesla, get ready to buy that dip. Okay, is it going to happen tomorrow? Based on what I see here, it doesn't look like that's happening, right? Maybe we'll see what happens later tonight, and we're going to try to buy that dip on the second 30-minute candle, and then try to get the gap fill, and that's the best trade setup that I can think of going into this week FOMC. I don't know if I want to trade FOMC. It's too complicated. What is going to happen when they officially raise interest rates? What is Jay Powell going to say after the interest rates? It's supposed to be bullish this week, but who knows? So, and the gap, I mean, when is that gap going to get filled? Is it this week or next week? Next week is usually pretty bearish after triple witching. So I just want to get into a trade where one part of the guessing is already done. So with Shopify or Apple, if Apple gaps down 5%, then the guessing is pretty straightforward. That's not a 5% move in the pre-market is very obvious that I should buy some calls, right? Because it's not going to go, it should not go any lower if the whole market is dumping 5%. That's the expected move on the day, okay? And that will make things a lot easier because most of the stocks did rally quite a bit at the open. For example, I even saw Roku rally, PayPal rally 3%, Facebook, the shittiest company in the world, rallied about 2%. And I think even maybe Amazon started to rally, but then it sold off late in the day. And Amazon, here you can clearly see there's a gap on the daily. It's still left open here at 2,806, which means that there's another leg down, maybe down to 2,600. Obviously, this is the bacon, so bacon, the lettuce would maybe form a doji to get that gap fill, and then maybe we reverse. This looks like, to me, a potential wave 1, 2, and 3. So the pullback looks like a 60. Looks like a 61.8 retracement, which would still be setting up for a wave 3. Okay, so So if I look at Amazon's gap and I plan my trade around this gap, that's the low, that's the high, wave one. This is wave two, which is going to be chopping around here, right? So let's just say the 61.8, the golden ratio. And then three would be the next wave up. And I don't, I mean, three can go anywhere up there. One cannot go under one, four cannot go under one, and five is obviously going to be a lot higher. And if we look at wave one, the impulse move of wave one, and draw an extension from here to find out where the 1272 is, once wave two is completed, then wave three should be the 1618, because wave three here at the 1272 is going to be the magnitude of 2 to 3 compared to 0 to 1 is smaller. Wave three is always the largest wave, so that would make it go up to 3,189, which will take a certain amount of time. But managing risk here at the 1272 makes sense. Wave three, my best guess is 1618. And then wave five, depending on how wave four holds above wave one, would be up to 3,500. So that's the wave structure. And that's the time is wrong, obviously, because we don't know the time. We cannot predict the future. But the structure would be correct if Amazon holds above 2,671.45. Because if it breaks that ruins the whole structure. So wave two should end around here. And then we get a nice rally maybe in April up to 3,200. That's a pretty clean wave one, okay? And the wave two is underway, okay? So I wouldn't be looking to buy puts. I'd be watching Amazon trade around this level. Because if it does pick up and reverses, then it's going to try to do a double top to 2,990. That's the top of wave one, and then break out somehow to 3,078, which is 3,078. Three thousand seventy-eight is the 50-day moving average. Believe it or not. So the 50-day moving average is right there, the white line. But the S&P gap, if it drops and it drops 4%, then Amazon's beta for is around probably 2 to 3. So that would mean that Amazon could drop a maximum of 6%. Let's just say 3 for argument's sake. That's the same amount as the S&P, right? So S&P gap is around 3.58. So let's just say Amazon is beta is 1. Okay, that means it moves 1 to 1 with the S&P. So then Amazon should move down 3%. And that would be, yeah, so it could go all the way down to 23.6. It can retrace as much as low as close to a double bottom. Then you want to just be careful this week with the FOMC. Looking at Apple, obviously has a BLT characteristic, and it is super extended from the 6-day moving average by 3%, which is not that much compared to this one right here. take a look at the Bollinger Band on Apple on the daily. See, last time it touched the 4 standard deviation mark. So the next attempt to... next level for 4 standard deviation move for Apple would be at 142. And it looks like it triggers cycle 1 here. So 142 is the target for Apple. And does that mean we buy the dip? So it'll depend on which day of the week we're in. But monthly wise, Apple's Heikin Ashi candle's been going. It's whenever it goes off into this major sell-off, it doesn't look like it lasts that long, but the magnitude of the move post-pandemic has been almost 2 to 3 times greater than expected. So it could pull back to 139, which it did here. Seems like the orange line representing the 21-week moving average is not a bad area to watch for support for the market to reverse and trend higher up to 200. Let's take a look at Netflix. So Netflix has this crazy gap at 196, and I almost believe that if the S&P goes down 3.5%, beta for Netflix should be around 2 to 3. So that would be another 6% drop. That white gap there is a 39% drop. So, I don't know if that's going to happen. I'd be very careful with these types of trades. So I don't want to assume a 39% drop in Netflix. It's possible. And they did leave a massive gap open. And no one knows when that's going to fill. It could fill before earnings. It could fill on the day of the earnings. It could fill after earnings. So you can see how much uncertainty there is with even me going through the charts. So that's why I'm recommending, if you're going to day trade light, 1 or 2 contracts, right? There's nothing wrong with making a couple of bucks here and there. But if you're looking to put some big risk, like $5,000, $1,000, you know, $10,000, whatever your balance is, right? If you're taking a little bit more risk, like a 20% or 5% risk in the market, wait for the market to flush, and that will give you a lot better chance, and it'll be easier to anticipate because I'm already anticipating it for you. Now, the only bad thing with my approach is that it's the opportunity to cost from now till when it happens. That's money, right? But at the same time, you also should think that if you do get into day trades and you lose on them, you know, that's money that you're preserving. So I would just eliminate the assuming and just get ready for that flush, buy that dip, and then stagger into positions for weeklies and for the contracts for next week if that opportunity presents itself. The next one is SHOP. So SHOP has been trading within the 1.8 standard deviation bands, and the next standard deviation, 4 standard deviation move is at 259. Is that going to happen? Well, you know, I don't know, but if the S&P gap is so S&P moved 0.5% today, and that's Shopify moved 5%. Right on 0.5, so you double that, so that would be about so that's 6, that's so that's 0.5, and we're expecting another 4% move for the S&P. Then that actually is correct. The next move would be either, yeah, 20, shoot. Six, yeah, it's 6. It's a multiple of 6. So 30% move Right around there, 361 is the next target for shop, believe it or not. And they left a little nice little gap here on the 78-minute time frame that is approximately 14%, which is huge. Now, those are some pretty big moves. And Boeing, oh, I used to have so many people ask me to turn on the Boeing algorithm. I know everyone really likes to trade Boeing because it's America's darling, but you have to understand this market is going to, when it sells off, everything sells off. And actually, if you take a look at Boeing, it on the with the Wolf Wave here, it actually held that 6-day moving average, which is actually really encouraging. So to this week could be Boeing's breakout week. I actually am kind of interested in that, but trading calls on Boeing. And I think because if it's opening up a little higher tomorrow morning, like around 176, I think there's a good chance it moves all the way up to this level here at 180 within 1 or 2 days. So that's a doji, and it could, all these dojis have the potential for big moves, but at the same time, it does look like a doji with the BLT setup to the downside, right? So let's take a look at that one more time, because that's a BLT, right? And there's lots of gaps. Like, this is, look at the way that Boeing trades. This is not the best looking chart. And that BLT, if you know BLT, right, just be careful what's going to happen on Tuesday. So, like I said, there's so much uncertainty. We got war, we got interest rates, we got Jay Powell. I highly recommend just 1 or 2 more weeks, and then we're done with this garbage, right? The garbage of what is this going to happen? What if this happens? There's going to be a lot of uncertainty going to be removed after FOMC, and then once we get the gap filled, then more of the uncertainty is gone. And if we can just hold out and look for great, like, wait, look for the flushes or the rip your face off rallies. Rip your face off rallies, I even tried that with Tesla last week. I bought puts when it was up like 3%, and it still didn't make money. Okay, so here with Boeing or anything else, there's a lot of uncertainty going into the week, and definitely there could be a massive rip your face off rally, right, on one of these days. I might try to see if I can catch one. Let's take a look at the VIX. Yeah, it's hard to catch a rip your face off rally. And I think we even saw the market even sell off when the VIX was dropping. So that even makes it more difficult. Usually when the VIX is dropping, markets are rallying. But eventually the VIX will drop minus 10%, plus 10%. These are days where we need to kind of get ready. For okay, it could happen tomorrow, it could happen this week, the flush could happen. I'm thinking more flush because we're just 4% away. So this week I'm looking for the flush, and if it happens, then it's great, then we can buy some calls. And if it doesn't, then I'm gonna just have to revert back to trading TGIF, or trading off of these algorithms, because honestly, this market is getting like really difficult even for me. So in terms of what I'm managing, we're actually doing much better than, I think Berkshire Hathaway is doing very well. Yeah, look at Berkshire. Holy cow. Berkshire Hathaway is like monster. It's actually from January to here, We're actually very similar. We're actually very close to Berkshire Hathaway performance. I think we're about the same, depending on the size you count. We're up about 10 to 5% this year in 750R. So that's great. We're doing as good as one of the best, right? Whereas when you look at ARK, you know, there's going to be a lot of broke, sad people in the States, maybe in all around the world who invested in this. This is pretty bad. This would take, I think, 2 to 3 years to recover. It will recover. It's just right now, and I would like it to recover, because it recovers, then I make money a lot more and faster. But it's just not recovering at all. Right, and actually, we're not anywhere near this. We're actually 80% outperforming this index by 80%, because they have to catch up. Okay, so yeah, I mean, there's so much uncertainty. You might be thinking, where can I make money? What can I do? And I've been in the situations before. All you gotta do is, if you have a system with me and obviously you're making money, or you haven't lost any, then just keep with the status quo and just keep on managing. Just think of it, try to pretend you're like a parrot, but you actually have like a really good system, and just wait for the for at least 1.8 years for your system to truly show real profits. Especially if you didn't start on January, because that's there's time is a big factor in the whole play. In terms of options and conclusion, I want to just let everyone know that the day trading is a little bit complicated, fast, and if you're able to manage your trades, then go ahead, trade light. But I'm looking for a flush to buy the dip on some of these names, so that's my plan. And if there is a rip your face off rally, I might be looking to try the short one more time on some puts. Okay, that's basically my plan. Thank you very much for your time, and I will be on Voice tomorrow morning. Thank you.